why do we want to really focus on the strategy involved with executing a great redesign project? So, you know, typically people get excited about the design phase and the colors and the design and content and all this fun stuff. And really getting into building the site, it's a lot. That's the fun part. The strategy maybe is not as fun. Sometimes we see organizations really skip over some critical strategy steps. They'll get their site built, right? And then they'll say, yeah, we're going to do some blogs this year. We should do some marketing personas for those. And it's like, well, you should have probably done those before the site was redesigned, right? Because that informs a lot of the process. And there's a lot of other sort of strategy steps that may get skipped or glossed over that really make a big impact during your redesign project. So having a very solid strategy does a lot of things for you. It's going to help you conserve your budget and really prioritize things. It's going to make sure that you can get the most out of your budget, stay on time, meet the deadlines. If you have a deadline of when you want it to launch or when you want certain things done, having the strategy all done is going to help with that. It's going to help you avoid some major mistakes. For instance, not having enough content for a specific audience, or not having CTAs for a specific group, or you're going to have, say, a capital campaign or some kind of campaign running, and you don't have the right content on the site to support it, all of these things. It's going to add a lot of longevity to your site. As many times I'll have a client come to me and their site's only a year old or maybe 2 years old, and they want to do a redesign. And I'm thinking, this site should have lasted a lot longer than a year or two. What went wrong? And many times it's they didn't do the strategy, right? Oh, the new site's done, but we have a new brand. It doesn't reflect that. Or we have a tweak to our mission, or we have a new persona. The site isn't inclusive of those things. That's a sign maybe the strategy wasn't done early enough. So it's going to make for a site that lasts longer, which is always great, right? And it's going to make for a much more effective website. The goals that you have organizationally and how your website fits into that and helps you meet those goals, it's going to be much more effective for meeting those goals. And continuity with ongoing marketing efforts and supporting that, right? You don't just build a site and then never touch it again. You build a site and you put your news up there. You try to get donations, newsletter subscribers, you do blogging, all these different things and ongoing communications, right? To grow your mission and grow your organization. And if you have very solid strategy for the site and are thinking about that from the get-go, the website's going to support all of those efforts much, much, much better. So let's get into the first big chunk of strategy. And these are basically the main components for the redesign strategy components. So these are kind of the big buckets we're going to talk about first, which is your brand and style, your audience and content, and what are the goals and what are the calls to action and the interactive components that are going to support those goals. These are kind of the three first big buckets. And we're going to go first into brand and style here and talk about this. So your brand and style is made up a lot of different components. Of course, the visual style, but also the voice and how your brand sounds. So when it comes to the visual style and the visual representation of your brand, you have things like your logo, your sort of official color palette, but also how you use imagery. Do you use photography? Do you use illustrations? How do you combine those components? Do you have different colors that represent different things? You know, do you have themes to your imagery and all of these types of things? And sort of establishing this first as part of your strategy, how do you want to visually represent your brand? This is a very, very valuable thing for a redesign project. So many times you may have a brand guide, which is very simple. This is what our logo looks like. These are the different, you know, variations of it, the monochrome, the color, this, that. You probably have an official color palette. I would even extend that in the strategy step and develop, sometimes we call them style tiles, or we call them, you know, digital style guides, where you take those things, you take the logo, the imagery, the photos, illustrations, colors, even text and your fonts, and you kind of combine them all into this guide, which will help with developing and styling your site. So this is helpful even before sort of the design stage, right? you go into actually laying out and designing your site. This is just going to make sure that your brand and the design of the new site's really on brand and your brand is represented well. And I need to talk a little bit about color too, because we're going to talk about visual cues, how color affects things, how visual design cues help users understand content, but also in the mindset of inclusivity and accessibility. And this is a thing I've run into a lot. And it's a very important to strategically use your colors, your brand colors. So many times what happens is brand colors, especially in the nonprofit world, which may have softer palettes or, you know, not as contrasty palettes, maybe, you know, more kind of nuanced. Many times your official brand colors, they may not be able to meet accessibility standards. For instance, you may want to use a brand color as a background with some white text, not enough contrast. So you won't meet, you know, accessibility standards. So brand colors usually are best used for sort of accents. So if your brand palette doesn't have neutrals or it doesn't have enough contrast, you're going to probably have to consider expanding your palette a bit. And of course, not every single visual piece has to, you know, meet accessibility standards. You can have design elements and different things that don't necessarily need to have a certain level of contrast. You can use your brand colors for those, but anything that's critical to the understanding or function of your site, those need to meet, of course, accessibility standards. So that's a big thing I've seen a lot of nonprofits struggle with, is they kind of come up with how they want to use their brand colors in their site, and it causes accessibility problems. So one thing you can do is you can use tools like this WebAIM, a contrast checker, to measure the contrast and make sure that if you want to use these colors in combination, that they will meet accessibility standards. I would also say this, that I highly recommend, and we're seeing this more common, I highly recommend you bake accessibility into your style guide. Meaning if you have an older style guide or have one that doesn't mention accessibility at all, to put that in there. So maybe take a look at your style guide and where it talks about fonts and colors and text, and make sure there is instructions in there for designers and developers on how to use those colors and have the contrast numbers in there so people understand what they can use and what combination to still stay within accessibility guidelines. So that's a big part of planning your brand, how it's represented visually and the strategy around that. Another thing related to your brand is the voice. How does it sound? How does your organization sound? How does it speak? You know, this is sort of your communication style, and it has to do with the tone, the type of language you use. Is it more formal? Is it more informal? Is it serious? Is it playful? How are you trying to communicate? Is it to entertain, to engage, inform, to advocate, to educate? There's these different sort of purposes to the language. And then there's also technical details, which have more of an impact really on SEO. But there's technical details like how is your name abbreviated? How is it written? You want to always use your name and written language the same way. This actually helps Google connect the dots between all of your online content. The same with your phone number. Your phone number should always be written the same way. If you use dots or dashes or whatever, the one in front of the area code, your address as well, how your address is used, is Avenue spelled out, is it abbreviated? Those things seem trivial, but they actually matter a lot, especially for localized SEO. Having extreme consistency between those technical details helps. And this little picture here is part of a workbook. And I'm going to show you more pieces of this workbook. It's called our Communications Toolkit. And it's a strategy workbook and guide with different things in it and exercises to help you with this strategy work before a redesign. That's going to be all emailed to you, and you can download it and use it as much as you want. That will be in the email that follows this webinar. So look for that. I'm going to show throughout the webinar a bunch of pages from this. And this is the one, this is a strategy activity from it on brand, style, and voice. And you can see a little bit of what it has here, but there's multiple pages. And this, if you have no framework at all, this is a really good way to help dial in that brand voice. I'm going to switch the poll here. Thanks for answering that polls or those polls. Here's another one about style guides. So again, if you have an older style guide, maybe update it, maybe look at this workbook and grab some ideas from it. And definitely, I highly recommend you look at your brand guide and think about accessibility. So the next major piece, strategy work, is going to be your audience. This is really important. And this is whenever we embark on a redesign project and the client does not have established personas or has really old ones or hasn't even thought about it, I'm always, whoa, let's pump the brakes. Because dialing in your audience and your personas is so important to everything, to how the site looks, how it functions, the design, the content, the calls to action, kind of everything, right? So I always say, you know, if you're trying to speak to everyone, you're really speaking to no one. You need to dial in the strategy stages of your redesign, the audience, and how you're going to engage with them. So a big step of the audience is identifying what are the key personas. And a persona is basically a fictional person we make up, which talks a little story about who they are, their life, how they interact with your brand and organization, what are the other adjacent organizations they work with, what motivates these people, what are they looking from you, what are their main challenges, what are their motivators, habits, online digital habits, all of this stuff is really contained in a persona. And it's very, very valuable. I can't stress that enough. What we try to do is we try to base these on actual real people. So say you want to have a donor persona and a participant persona, a volunteer persona. We'll say, okay, if you want to develop a donor persona, who is a phenomenal donor that you just love, that's contributed year after year, that's an advocate for you, that's a real ambassador? Who is that ideal donor? And we will actually base the fictional persona partly on the real person. And that is very valuable. So these can be one page like that's shown here. Each persona is just one simple page. They can be that, and you can start small and start with just one and start with one maybe main donor persona. And as you branch out and you realize, you know, we have two big motivators. We have donors that used to use services like we have and they're passionate about the cause. We have, you know, other donors who have a different motivation. Maybe that donor persona splits into two. So you can always do that. You can start small. Many times, if you're engaging with us for persona work, we'll develop multi-page personas that could be, you know, 10 to 20 pages long that go very into detail with fictional quotes from the person, a breakdown of the digital habits of their personal profile and motivators and a whole background thing and sort of the engagement profile. How do they engage with you over time? How do they discover you? What turns them from, you know, knowing about you to donating, to advocating, and all those different steps. So the persona work, we do a lot of that, and it's very, very valuable. It's an incredibly important strategic step to any redesign project. So it looks like only 17% of you said you have established style guides. A lot of you said you have one, but nobody uses it, which is actually common. Unfortunately, that's kind of common. So I would recommend to get people to use your style guide, make it as encompassing as possible, review it once a year, update it once a year, you know, keep it in front of people. So thank you for those polls. So let's talk a little bit about the next major step, which is evaluating your current site. So we're talking about redesigns here. We are assuming you have a site and you're redesigning it. And there is a lot of good information you can get from your current site. Maybe even if your current site's maybe not a great performer for your organization, it's not driving a lot of donations or action, there's still things you can learn from it. For sure, you know, you want to review it before you start a redesign. Of course, to not repeat the same mistakes and improve things and leverage what's working, right? There's probably something already working on your site. The first big step to evaluating your current site is really looking at your analytics. And it's probably Google Analytics or maybe another tool. There's many analytics tools. I'm sure all of you have Google Analytics. So you're going to want to pay attention to, especially in your analytics, what are your top pages and top content? What is the content people are spending a lot of time on? What is it resonating? You know, that's who is it resonating with? And you know, the events and goals in your site. Hopefully in analytics, you're tracking some custom events, some goals, maybe donation button clicks or some kind of conversion. Hopefully you're tracking that stuff. Pay attention to the content people have have looked at when they did those actions. Pay attention to where they're coming from, which is called, you know, user acquisition. Where are they coming from? Are we getting more donations from certain social channels versus other? You know, is our organic search really low? How are people finding us? Is it mostly branded words? Are they searching for our organization instead of what we do? All of these things are an important strategic step. And a lot of times to let you know two things, how to change the structure of your site. Is the structure need to be improved? And the content, you know, what content is working now that we want to keep, right? If you have a section of your site doing really well, driving a lot of organic traffic, you probably don't want to monkey with it too much. You probably want to keep it somewhat similar if it's performing, right? But of course, add and improve. So looking at your analytics is a very big step to the planning process. And for redesigns where you're really going to change the look and the feel, I highly also recommend a UX review. And this is something that isn't super common. Like, I've run across very few clients who have done this before or even asked for it or suggested it. But this is a big deal. The UX review is sort of goes beyond analytics. So all analytics can tell you is what people loaded on from your site, what pages they saw, you know, how many pages they went to, the time they spent, where they went. But a UX review tracks more than just when pages are loaded. It tracks the scrolling. It tracks clicks, even if it's a click on something that doesn't go anywhere. It tracks interactions. You know, what are people doing on the site? So this is really helpful for a redesign because it's going to show you if you have some UX issues now. Are people clicking on things that aren't actionable? Are they, you know, what parts of the site are they using a lot? Where are they scrolling to and spending time on? So this is a UX review tool we use a lot called Crazy Egg. There's many of them. So this is showing a heat map and scroll map and all the clicks and user interactions. And you can see it's broken down by like a mobile view on the right and the desktop view on the left. And that's another thing. This will show you the difference between how people use things on mobile versus desktop. And if you haven't really, really paid attention to mobile yet, you really do need to, because that is huge for Google, for the visibility of your site online. And mobile traffic just keeps becoming more and more and more of the overall mix of traffic. So a UX review, I highly recommend if you can do it. We basically own the tools to do it in every redesign project with us. This is a step we pretty much always take. And you can even take it a bit further if you want. And you can use a tool like Hotjar or some other tool to solicit feedback on your actual current site. You know, if you've got areas that people go to find information, you can have a quick little thing, thumbs up, thumb down, was this useful? Or rate this page's content from 1 to 5. You can conduct polls and surveys through Hotjar, do screen recordings to see a session where people are clicking, you know, what they're doing. So this is even another step, which you can do. You know, if you've got 6 months or a year before you're starting, you want to gather feedback, tools like this can be really helpful. Another part of sort of the strategy is really looking more globally, organizationally, what are the objectives? If this isn't really nailed down, what you want your website to do for you, your redesign project is probably not going to be as successful. So really looking at our organization overall, what are our goals? What do we want the website to do? Where does it fit in? And this is kind of three big categories. Is really your mission and your services. Have you added a new service since your last website was designed? Is there a tweak to your mission? Are you approaching something differently? Are the things that are the top priorities in your current site still the top priorities? Or do you need to refresh that? And then how are you fitting in into the market? And even if you're a nonprofit, you're not selling anything. There's probably other nonprofits doing the same thing or similar. So how do you fit into that whole marketplace? And competitors, meaning, you know, someone is having an issue with food scarcity and they're looking at different food banks or different services right now. Where do you fit in with that? What is your positioning? What is your secret sauce? What do you do better than these other ones or differently? And then goals. What were the goals for the past website? Were you trying to get donations on your site? You wanted it to be a source of donations that wasn't happening. You know, did you have the right conversion opportunities, CTAs in place? Looking at all those kinds of things. So these are more important sort of global things to look at. And they relate to your kind of your goals, that third strategy component, your goals and your calls to action. And we find if you want your website to do something for you, if you want your website to really drive action, it is really important in the strategy step to really be strategic and plan out how are calls to action going to work. How is the site supposed to drive action? And if you have certain actions and goals you want the site to do, you have to make sure the design supports it, the calls to action are in place, the content around it supports it. So this is just an example from a redesign project from Emma Norton. It's just a small piece of the page, not the whole page. But they have in the footer of every page a fund a need area. So instead of just asking blanket for donations, they're telling you right here what dollar amounts do what. You know, for $100, every kid that month will get a birthday party. I mean, so it's showing, really showing the impact. And this is their CTA strategy, is to tie the dollars to the impact. And they always have some piece of content that's a really quick overview that's 30 seconds, whether it's video or written, near these things. So if you're new, you want to really see what they do, you can quickly understand what the organization does, why they're special, why they have this need, and then the dollar amounts and what they actually do for people. So it's very cool. It's a very cool way of strategically implementing CTAs to have the site drive action. And this redesigned site does drive a lot more donations from their previous site and a lot more from out of state, which was a very interesting thing that happened with COVID. And they started paying a lot more attention to online and doing less in-person things, more online content. It all actually helped their site drive a lot more donations.